Welcome back. Today we'll be talking about the issue of scale as it relates to the topics of this course. Some of the ideas I'll be presenting in this lecture come from a book that I wrote in 2010 called Greening Through IT that discussed some environmental issues in information technology. And this came out through MIT Press a few years ago. The core argument in the book is that environmental issues tend to take place on broad scales of time, space, and complexity. They occur across thousands of miles and hundreds of years and are vastly complex, interacting among many different domains. Whereas the time horizons of these issues are different from the ones that humans are potentially more familiar with. So there are things like sea level rise that take place over 50 or 100 years rather than an earthquake, which is pretty instantaneous. There's a distinction between being urgent versus being important, that a lot of the things humans are good at responding to are urgency, not necessarily importance. And this is a distinction that I think is critical. So sea level rise is one example. And so here we see a graph from 1880 to the year 2000. And this only demonstrates a few centimeters worth of sea level change. And yet, the fact that it is this inexorable rise and that it's forecast to continue up leads to some pretty significant challenges where large portions of human habitation will be underwater at a certain point. And this appears to be something that's an ongoing trend. While these environmental issues are broad in time, space, and complexity, humans evolved with regard to a relatively narrow set of problems. We evolved to deal with narrow things in time, space, and complexity. The kind of feedback loop that evolution allows for is only on the scale of human bodies. So in terms of time, at most tens of years, but often shorter times than that. In terms of space, usually within arm's reach, but certainly no more than a couple of years walking distance. And in terms of complexity, our brains aren't necessarily good at synthesizing vastly different domains all at the same time. So we're relatively narrow in terms of complexity. One demonstration of this, there exists a system called Mechanical Turk. This is an Amazon product where you can go online and you can pose questions to people. And there are something like 10,000 people who are there willing to answer your question for a dime or 50 cents. And I went and did a study, just sort of a back of the envelope calculation with this, where what I asked was, what is the relevant time scale for a variety of different topics? I asked them to say, what was the time scale for danger, for hunger, for information technology, for financial issues, and for environmental topics? And the outcome, when I asked people this, was that danger tended to happen on the scale of about 1.2 hours. Hunger was about 4.2 hours. Information technology was on 3.2 months. Financial things was 7.2 months. And environmental topics were 8.1 years. So here we see the difference between the scale of various different topics. On this graph, it's very hard to see because 8.1 years is so high compared to 1.2 hours. And I wanted to show you another way to look at these same data. This is looking at the same graph on a log scale, a logarithmic scale. And here you can see the relationship between them a lot more clearly. A logarithmic scale is based on powers of 10. So when you, the first line is the ones, then the next line would be times 10, the next line would be times 100, the next line would be times 1,000. And so this allows you to see exponential variables, exponential growth, rather than linear variables better. And one thing I would encourage you to do in terms of thinking about scale is to go look at this XKCD comic, which I think does an interesting job of pointing out the relative scales of a lot of different things in the scope of human experience. So looking at this distinction between large-scale environmental problems and relatively small-scale human problems, there's an important role for technology, that across human history, technology has bridged the gap between large scales and small scales. So the core argument in my book is that environmental issues take place over big time scales and space scales, and human horizons are relatively small, but that throughout human history, technology has allowed us to make connections between these small scales and larger scales, as well as between small scales and even smaller scales. And that information technology in particular is well suited for this effort. But I also wanted to make a point about books. Ultimately, they're written by people. I'm just a guy, and I wrote this book. and parts of them are wrong. Sometimes they're even wrong by the time they're in print. So there are various aspects of the Greening Through IT book that when I read them, I'm like, ooh, I wish I hadn't written it quite like that. Hopefully they provide some sort of a useful perspective, but when you read a book, note that it's just written by a person who had some opinions and they thought they'd write them down. And often they're an expert in the field, but that doesn't mean they're necessarily necessarily perfect in their understanding of a topic or that their understanding doesn't change over time. There's another potential way to look at the idea of scale, and this is looking at first-order effects, second-order effects, and third-order effects. So first-order effects are relatively narrow in their perspective. So efficiency, for example, as a first-order effect, seems like a really good thing. It gets the same work done with less energy, and that seems like it would be clearly sustainable. But looking at a second-order effect, these are broader indirect effects. So if you do something more efficiently, then you save some money. And what do you do with that money? You may go out and spend it on a trip to Hawaii or somewhere. And that then means that the money that you saved might have other environmental issues. And these are second-order effects. Third-order effects are broader still. These are broad-scale civilizational effects, things like the existence of a culture of consumption, where people just get in the habit of using a lot of stuff because it's so freely available. So an interesting finding in the area of indirect effects comes from a thing called the Jevons Paradox. So in 1865, William Stanley Jevons was doing a study of steam engines in England. And what he was expecting to find in his study was that as steam engines became more efficient, the overall use of coal would go down. But what he found was actually the opposite, that as steam engines became more efficient, more and more coal was being used. And that's not because any given steam engine for a given period of time was using more coal, but it was that more steam engines were being used. Steam engines were being used in more industries, and they were being used for more tasks and for longer periods of time. So that even though they were becoming more efficient, the overall use of coal went up during that period of time. And that's why it's a paradox. More efficiency led to more coal use instead of less coal use. So President Obama's executive order from a few years ago calls for increased energy efficiency as part of the federal government's, quote, integrated strategy towards sustainability. But there's a question, does efficiency necessarily lead to greater sustainability? Efficiency certainly leads to greater economic prosperity, or at least very likely, that it allows you to do more stuff with the same resources, and so it leads to prosperity. But does it lead to sustainability? That depends a lot on some of the indirect effects. So it makes perfect sense why a government would be exactly in favor of efficiency because of economic prosperity. But this complex relationship between efficiency and sustainability is also an important part of this topic. Another aspect that impinges upon this is the time lag on indirect effects. So whereas direct effects take place immediately, indirect effects often take weeks or months or years or decades to ripple through all of the interconnected systems and have their effect. So the time discounted value of all direct and indirect effects might be another way to think about it. What's the value over the course of time that these indirect effects have? So various changes like increased efficiency might buy us time to address some of these other issues as well, but it also may just delay the point at which we feel like we, as a civilization, need to think about some of these sustainability issues. In the field of science, scale also plays an important role. Different sciences look at different phenomena at very different scales, and disciplines sometimes will migrate within that same discipline across a variety of different scales. So as an example, traditional ecology research has been a relatively small-scale phenomenon. It was a field research activity where individual researchers would go out into the wild and engage in harsh conditions with notebooks and pencils slogging around in the mud. As an example of this, there's a professor who's recently retired, a couple of years ago retired from UCI, named Lynn Carpenter, who studied Costa Rican restoration ecology, so trying to turn fields that have been over-farmed back into usable farmland and ultimately potentially into rainforest. And her field site was full of muddy boots and milk crates full of plants, and that was the way in which she engaged with her research, and she was doing some really important and interesting work in that capacity. But over the last few years, or actually the last few decades, ecology has become much more of a big science, where there are many different researchers who are trying to integrate across their different studies and doing cross-domain research. Rather than thinking about one species in one location, they might be thinking about many different species in the same location, or the same species in many different locations. The complexities among all of these different projects, rather than one particular species in one location. And ecoinformatics is the field that looks at how information technology can be brought to bear on ecology as a science. So using information technology to enhance ecological research and change the way that ecological research can happen. But here we have a challenge. How do you bridge the gaps among thousands of different scientists with millions or billions of different data points, all collected in different ways? One person is collecting data using one set of techniques and somebody else is using a different set of techniques. How do you bridge this gap? How do you merge across different species and the geographies and different habitats and data quality? So for example, citizen scientists are regular citizens of a given country who are being enlisted to do things like count the number of birds that they see out of their back window each day. And the data quality that you get from that may not be as reliable as a PhD student or some other researcher who's being paid to sit there and count the birds. And yet, it allows for a much broader set of activities when you can enlist thousands of citizens rather than just a few researchers. The reason I wanted to address all of these topics of scale is to cause you to think a little bit more about the role of scale in your projects and in the way you think about the topics of this class. Because environmental issues and sustainability issues have a lot of scale aspects involved in them. And hopefully IT can be brought to bear productively in addressing some of these scale issues. And over the course of this quarter, would like you to think very much about how scale affects all the different topics of the class. Thanks very much.